Chris back with another powerful mini PC. This one is an absolute monster. Got it from Banggood. It's called the T-Bao MN59. Now it's powered by the Ryzen 9 5900HX. That's a 45 watt part, 8 cores, 16 threads with Vega 8 graphics. And in my time testing it out, it's impressive. It does really well considering that it doesn't have a dedicated GPU, but you can still play games like Cyberpunk 2077 with around an average of 40 frames per second at 720p. Pretty impressive. And then of course, the 8 cores. This thing is super quick. Now it does come with 32 gigabytes of RAM, which is DDR4 spec. We've got 2 slots of them there, so SODIMM. You can upgrade that RAM if you wanted to. And it comes with a 1 terabyte NVMe drive, Wi-Fi 6E with Bluetooth 5, and we do have up to 3 displays that it can run. So in this review, I'll be testing it out. I'll let you know all the pros and the cons of the MN59 here. And this is the box that comes in, and what we get with this mini PC, pretty straightforward. So we've got a SATA connector, 2 Wi-Fi antennas, power cable, power brick, which is 100 watts, that one, and then our user manual, which is just basically a Windows 10 user manual. At the back of this mini PC, we have 2 wireless antennas, external ones, high gain, that I've already screwed in. You can see right here, we've got 2 3.5mm separate audio jacks there, which is good to see. Gigabit LAN, 2 USB 3 ports, 2 USB 2, full spec USB 3.1, but this does not take power actually, so it's not full spec. So don't plug in power delivery because it's not going to work and you could end up damaging it. But 4K 60 out of that, 4K 60 from the display port, and then our HDMI port here at the bottom is HDMI 2.0. That's our DC in for power. So either side, there are just these vents here, so it's sucking in a bit of fresh air. And then up the front here, we've got 2 USB 2s, which I really wish were USB 3 ports, but I guess it's good for a mouse and keyboard. Power button with status LED. You see there's more vents here on that side. On the top, we've just got where the fan is, so that's another vent here. And then on the bottom, more vents. But there is no mounting points here for a VESA mounting bracket, which is unfortunate. So you can't mount this on the back of a monitor or a TV. Now the internals, very easy to access. You've just got 2 screws that you remove from the back of it, and then the whole top of it pops right off. So you can see our cooler here, plenty of fins in there, and we've got 2 transfer thermal copper transfer pipes there for it. 2 SODIMM slots, so you can upgrade the memory with this. Now it does come with DDR4 3200 megahertz spec, and we get 32 gigabytes. So both of these are 16 gigabyte sticks that they have installed. Now the timing is typical for AMD. It's CL22, so it's not amazing timing. I mean, in my Intel PC, I'm currently running in a laptop CL16 with XMP, right? But we don't get it here with AMD. Our NVMe drive, that's right in there. Now you can easily upgrade that too. And you'll see that we do have room for a SATA 3 2.5-inch drive, which is going to go in here. We've got 2 connectors, but they only supply the 1 cable to us because really we can only fit one of them in here. You can see that these antennas go to where the wireless card is, just below the NVMe SSD. You can upgrade that one too, which is great. And here's that Wi-Fi card. So the model is a MediaTek one. It's the MT7921K, so it is a Wi-Fi 6 card, which is great to see, but I wish they'd gone with Intel's AX200 or the 200-in-1 Wi-Fi 6 card. Why? Because you get better driver support if you're looking to run Linux, that is. If you do have a keen eye, you would have noticed that there's this too as well, an empty fan header. So you could run another fan if you wanted to cool the insides of this mini PC, because that one, of course, that it's connected up right now is designated to the CPU fan. First up, our BIOS. So we do have some settings that are open to us under advanced. You've got a lot that you can tweak. Most of those settings will be in this one. So AMD, CBS, CPU options. You've got the MBIO common options where you can go and adjust power limits and things like that. Even dedicate more RAM to the Vega 8 graphics this has with this chipset, of course. So I won't go into all of that because there's a lot of different settings that can get you into a bit of trouble. So really experienced users only for that. Then you've got your boot set up there. Of course, you can go and change your boot order. And that's basically it for our BIOS.
Okay, so here in Windows now, it did originally come with Windows 10 Home, right? But I didn't like it because it was already set up. You went straight into the desktop. And I don't think for security reasons, that's a good idea. So I'm on Windows 11 here, which does work without a problem on this mini PC. Now, looking at the device manager, you'll see that, yes, we do have that Ryzen 9 5900HX listed 16 times because it has 8 cores and 16 threads. Maximum turbo with this one is 4.65 gigahertz, and it's a 7 nanometer chip, and it has Vega 8 graphics. So with our internet here, we do have, of course, the gigabit LAN port I pointed out, and then the MediaTek chipset, which is Wi-Fi 6E. Now, it's very quick. I'm getting really good speeds, around 1.35 gigabits per second, which is kind of typical for the Asus router that I have, a Wi-Fi 6 router, of course, to match it there. So the performance of the system, I won't go into general things like Chrome, documents, or spreadsheets. It's very fast. Everything's quick, loads up quick, internet's working quick. All good there. I'll get onto some benchmarks here. So Cinebench, start out with this one first. So it's done the 10-minute stress test here, and it's got some excellent scores here. I mean, this thing's a monster. Over 12,000 points here with Cinebench R23. That's a really good score. You can see that's a lot better than the 8-core previous gen now with the Intels. Okay, so the 11800H. I can actually get higher than that with my own unit if you increase the wattage. But this is running stock, okay? I've not changed anything here. So very, very good here. Even the single core score is excellent. Now taking a look then at some other benchmarks, Geekbench 5, single core score, because of that 4.65 gigahertz turbo on this chip, very good. And an absolute rock solid here, multi-core score, over 9,000 points because of the 16 threads there. It's a monster. It's very, very quick. Now, when it comes to our integrated graphics, Night Raid here, is the one they do recommend for integrated graphics. So it's getting almost 17,000 points. And the graphics score here, you can see almost 18,000. CPU score is really strong. When you take a look at comparing that then to the Iris Xe with the 96 executional cores, similar, but it's falling behind a little bit. You can see the Iris Xe graphics certainly does a bit better. They're getting almost 2,000 points or so more. Okay, and that does happen with Firestrike Extreme here. That is a similar kind of score too to what you'd get on the Iris Xe graphics, but the Iris Xe graphics can actually pull around 2,000 points here. There's not too much of a difference in it, but I do find this slight edge going to the Iris Xe graphics from Intel, which is actually newer architecture there with that one. Then our NVMe drive speeds here. So this is PCIe 3.0 spec. We don't have PCIe 4 spec with AMD yet. Let's see what happens with the 6000 series. Anyway, these scores, okay, for an as-int 1 terabyte drive. I was expecting a little bit better with the writes, considering it is 1 terabyte. So if you want quicker, get something like Samsung's 970 or 970 Evo. Put one of those in, and then you get around 3500. Sequential reads and writes, they are very quick, and better random 4Ks too. But it's fast, okay? A lot faster than SATA 3 there, of course. Speaking of fast and great performance is this, video playback, okay? So this is my test clip, 10-bit HEVC, 4K, 140 megabits per second, absolute no problems, absolute ease that it can play it, okay? The Vega 8 graphics there. Then an HDR file, 60 frames per second. It runs at 60 frames per second, no lag. Again, just not a problem there. So anything you throw at it video-wise, this thing is going to handle with ease. This one's come up a few times, and that's 4K 60 streaming performance with YouTube. So I'm going to set it onto that highest possible setting there, enable our stats, and we'll see. Is it going to drop frames? I don't think it's going to drop many. Okay, 2. But I'm not actually looking at this full screen. So I'm going to full screen this now, and it's steadily dropping frames, as you can see here in Chrome. Now, if you do the same test in Edge, it's so much better. But it's disappointing to see. It's really, look at that. It's just continually dropping frames, although I'm not really seeing it too much. It's only a few frames, it seems. Around 7 frames a second, which, no, that's not actually too good, is it? So that's disappointing performance here with 4K 60 Chrome YouTube streaming. Now we do have that powerful 8-core, 16-thread Ryzen 9 in here, right? So video editing 4K with Adobe Premiere Pro should be very good.
Time up to 7.5 hours. I'm getting about 6 hours.
You can see the timeline has just a few little drop frames there at a quarter playback resolution. Now on full, it definitely feels to me a little bit laggy at times. Doesn't seem that bad, but you'll see when I hit play.
It's global, okay, so it's going to work this equal.
Not quite 30 frames per second there, but it's faring a lot better than the Iris Xe graphics in the Core i5 that I just recently reviewed, the 11320H, doing a much better job at that. So what about our export times? So going into just the option of the YouTube one is what I want here. So it's H.264 and down to YouTube 4K there. And we'll set this then to a minute. Just to confirm there, 1 minute of footage, the 4K preset. So I'm going to hit start on the timer and export. And wow, it's absolutely tearing through this. This is blazing quick, probably going to be around 35, 40 seconds. So this is a lot quicker than the Iris Xe graphics with the 96 executional units. Probably because of the 8 cores, 16 threads, it's definitely helping out with the export performance here. So only around 7 seconds to go. Once this disappears, I will hit pause here on my timer and we can get the exact time. Okay, so that's roughly 33 seconds. That's impressive. The Iris Xe graphics and the last mini PC I reviewed took 51 seconds. So that's a lot quicker here. Now look at this, this is Cyberpunk 2077 and it's running at 40 frames per second, 720p. This is really impressive. So that's even faster than the Iris Xe graphics, which was getting around 30, 34, 35. And I still have, you know, a bit of traffic going on here. So the performance, you could say, is almost better than what you'd get on a PlayStation 4. Definitely. Not the PlayStation 4 Pro, but a PlayStation 4. Look at this, 40 frames per second here. That's really good. Now, if I start to just attack people, it will get a little bit laggy with the action going on. You can see, but hey, still 40 frames per second. So this is really impressive for such a demanding game like Cyberpunk 2077. GTA 5 performance here is looking very good for integrated graphics, 1080p, normal settings, so normal in the middle really, view distance and pedestrian density. And inside the car here getting 70 frames per second, which is on average now a little bit higher than what I've seen with the Iris Xe graphics, so that's good to see. When I get out of the car, you'll see that that frame rate is going to increase now to around 90 frames per second, 92, so that's very good. And even with this, all this action going on, still very playable. Finally, The Witcher. So this is running at 1080p on the lowest settings. We're getting around 40 frames per second on average, which is good considering it's 1080p. Now, if you lower it down to 720p, the frame rate will then jump up to about 60 to 70. Frames per second, which is a lot better than this, and it's probably my recommended. You would really want to actually play this game at 720p on integrated graphics here, but if you can put up with just getting 40 frames per second at 1080p, then it's doable. Now remember, I'm in the dense built-up town here, so when you get out into the countryside with The Witcher 3 here, the frame rate is going to increase a lot, and it will go up about 20 frames per second on average. So that's excellent there. So overall, I'm impressed with this graphics performance considering that it's just integrated, remember? No dedicated GPU. Now looking at our temperatures, so it did get up to 100 degrees Celsius. That's very hot. That's when stress testing it, but normally it's only peaking around when gaming. You're probably seeing with my gaming performance tests that it's around 70 degrees. And when you run Cinebench, that's really when it gets up to this temperature. Otherwise, with normal kind of use, I'm not seeing those temps. But still, it shouldn't get this hot. Now, what about the power consumption? So around 10 watts at idle, and then up to about 92 watts is what I'm seeing under full load. Now, the fan noise, it does get a little loud when you push it really hard. So here's a sample of it under full load.
And as for Linux support, because I know a lot of you out there do like to run Linux on these kind of machines and tech, the same issue that I've had with other models with this MediaTek chipset in here, that RT Wi-Fi 6E card, unfortunately the build that I'm using of Linux Mint, maybe there's other distros out there that will support it, it's not running the wireless card. So that's the only issue there. You got the Gigabit LAN, which is Realtek, not a problem. The rest of it, everything else seems to be running just fine. So that's good. And Linux just absolutely flies, of course, on such a spec of machine, even with Windows. So I am really impressed with this model here. That Vega 8 graphics, for some reason, with this model, seems to be a lot better than some of the other mini PCs I've reviewed. So it's surpassing Iris Xe graphics at the, well, the 96 executional unit versions of them. It's better than those. And it's probably being helped, of course, definitely on the CPU side, that we've got 8 cores, 16 threads, immense power out of this thing. It's super powerful considering the size. The chipset is fantastic. And I know we do have the 6000 series coming. So should you buy this or hold off? Well, it depends on your needs, of course. If you need something that's powerful now, and you want a reasonably powerful integrated GPU, you don't need a dedicated GPU for, say, editing 4K videos or AAA games, whatever, you're just going to do light gaming, then this definitely covers. And if you think about waiting for the 6000 series, which will, of course, be better than this, you might even get things like PCIe 4 spec and better integrated graphics. However, it will be at least, I would say, almost a year before we're going to see them in models like this here. Now, the cons of this machine, for me, the definite one is the price tag. At the moment, at the time of this video, it's around 1,000 euros, so well over 1,000 US dollars. And I think that's a huge ask, really, considering, okay, yes, it does have 32 gigabytes of RAM, 1 terabyte NVMe storage. That's good, and it's very powerful. But you could build your own mini PC, your own little small form factor setup, probably for less and probably a lot, well, I don't know about more powerful, but well, maybe actually. So that's something they need to work on, is the pricing there. Now, if I do find a coupon for it for Banggood there to get it for less, I'll certainly put that down in the description of this video and in the comments there. I'll probably pin it if I find that. The other two is the fan noise. It's actually very good. Most of the time you're using this, especially when you're hardly doing anything demanding, it's great, okay? You hardly even hear it. It's just a little humming, whooshing noise going on in there. But when you do push it really hard, so when I was running Cinebench R23 for about like 20 minutes and then gaming and then doing lots of other things, it did eventually peak at 100 degrees Celsius. So it's a little too hot. Now, I've actually seen it in a lot of units with the 8 cores and 16 threads, both AMD and Intel side getting up to those kind of temperatures with this type of cooler on there. Now, the cooling, I think, is pretty good. The fan noise is just when you push it really hard, it gets a little irritating then. It does become a little bit loud from that sample I gave you. The other is, well, maybe a bit of a minor for some people, or maybe not, okay? But I really think we should have more USB 3 ports on them. Okay, we've got two USB 3 type A's, and then the type C port with USB 3.1 with the data and the video out, that's good. And we can run the other displays, but I would have liked to have seen, I think all of the USB ports on this should be USB 3 spec. Who needs four USB 2 ports? I mean, come on, in a powerful system like this, not great. There's no SD card reader, there's no secondary NVMe slot, which would have made this really great, because that means you could hook up an external GPU, which you can still do with this model, mind you, you can hook up an external GPU to it. But I would have preferred to just to have the two NVMe slots in this, I think, instead of the SATA. You've got the two SATA ports there, SATA 3, that's okay. So all up, it is one of the most powerful mini PCs that I've covered. It holds the Vega 8 graphics, that 2100 megahertz turbo, just rock solid the whole time. And that delivers fantastic performance. As you saw, Cyberpunk, over 40 frames per second, and around that average at 720p is impressive. And GTA 5 runs really well, better than Iris Xe graphics. It's good. When it's paired up with some decent RAM and this kind of spec, great. So if you need the power, by all means, this one has got plenty of it, especially for the size. So I'll have more mini PC reviews up and coming, so stay tuned for those. Some of them will be slightly older generation ones, but they do sell for a lot less than this one right here. So hope to see you then. Bye for now.